King Henry IV of France once said that in Spain, large armies starve and small armies are beaten. Well, the Duke of Wellington now has a very large army, and he knows, as his predecessor, the Duke of Marlborough, once said, that the British soldier will not fight unless he is properly fed on beef and beer. Now, Wellington was usually a master of logistics. He does get it horribly wrong once. After the failure of his siege at Burgos, his army almost runs out of food during its retreat. But usually he gets it spectacularly right. A story is told how a Spanish nobleman would not deliver 14 promised wagons of food and fodder because a British officer refused to bow down to him. Well, the Duke sorted him out. "I just bobbed down," he said. It's with such tact that Wellington leads his large army, an allied army now, of British, Spanish and Portuguese troops, right to the Pyrenees, and there at Vitoria they will thrash the French and send them on a retreat that will not stop in the mountains, but will go deep into France itself. And there, as we shall see in this episode, the eagles fell.
It seemed only a matter of time before Napoleon himself would have to abdicate and surrender to the Allies.
Wellington intended to fight the French in a great battle of encirclement from which there could be no escape.
And Wellington was so annoyed by this, he called his army the scum of the earth.
And for once, everything went right.
Wellington's ill-fated siege of Burgos began on the 19th of September 1812. "It was as foolish a piece of work as ever I saw Wellington encounter," wrote one soldier, who was present during the month-long investment, a sentiment that was probably shared by most of those that were there. Not only were the British troops short of trained engineers and equipment, they were also up against General de Breton, a fine French commander. But the problem was far greater than this. Wellington had blundered by failing to move quickly enough to catch the French forces in Old Castile, which were able to join up with other French troops in the Basque provinces to threaten the Anglo-Portuguese army with superior numbers.
Salamanca was an enormous triumph for Wellington. He had shown that he wasn't just a good defensive general. This was a man who could actually go on the offensive, and he knew how to win in a very spectacular fashion. Madrid is liberated, and Wellington then decides that the situation is right to drive the French from Spain once and for all. He strikes to the northeast, towards the main lines of communication, towards Burgos and Vitoria.
The French evaded battle, fell back beyond the Ebro, and Wellington was checked and forced to besiege Burgos, or rather its castle. It could have been taken very easily had Wellington brought an adequate siege train with him, but he hadn't. In consequence, the siege proved the most frustrating episode of his military career.
We now see Wellington really at the nadir of his military fortunes. Between September the 19th and October the 18th, the British launch 5 assaults at Burgos, and all 5 are repulsed. Most of them bloodily repulsed. By contrast, the French launch 2 sorties from Burgos, both of which inflict more casualties on the British besiegers than they do on the French. And then on October the 18th, Wellington learns that a French army is actually moving on his lines of communication. He has no option other than to retreat.
With other French forces closing on Madrid, Wellington decided to abandon the siege of Burgos on the 22nd of October and to withdraw towards Portugal. What was more, the Spanish capital, which only 2 months earlier had seen such scenes of jubilation, was evacuated on the 30th of October and was reoccupied by the French army 2 days later. It was all my fault, admitted Wellington, but his real problems had not yet started. The retreat towards Portugal was one more dreadful episode of so many dreadful episodes that epitomized the peninsula. The suffering of the British troops as they made their long march was certainly far worse than during the retreat from Lusaco, and, some thought, even worse than the infamous retreat from Corunna.
For those that had taken part in the retreat to Corunna and the retreat from Burgos, many of them regarded the retreat from Burgos as being by far the worst of the two. During the Corunna campaign, there was a rock to get behind or a hovel to get into. The retreat from Burgos, it was nothing but mile after mile of open plain.
At first, progress was good. 23rd of October, they made more than 25 miles. But then, inevitably, the autumn rains came. The road disintegrated. The soldiers marched through mud. Logistics broke down.
Sergeant Joseph Donaldson of the 94th Foot remembered,
"Retreating before the enemy at any time is a grievous business, but in such weather, it was doubly so. The rain was pouring down in torrents, drenching us to our skin, and the road, composed of clay soil, stuck to our shoes so fast they were torn off our feet. The cold wind blew in heavy gusts. Our situation was truly distressing. We were tormented by hunger, wet to the skin, and fatigued in the extreme. These were scenes that would have pierced our hearts at any time."
Very soon, discipline was breaking down. Over 1,000 were actually cut off and either captured or killed by the French. Another 2,000 during the course of the retreat succumbed to the weather, succumbed to the hunger. They were left on the roadside to die. Now it's instructive that exactly this time, Napoleon is conducting his own retreat on a much more spectacular scale from Moscow.
Ironically, at the same time as Wellington's troops were making the retreat to Portugal, the Emperor Napoleon was embroiled in Central Europe in one of the greatest military catastrophes of all time. This was the retreat from Moscow, the tragic culmination of a campaign in Russia that began with a French invasion force of 500,000 men. Barely 50,000 ever saw France again. By the 19th of November, Wellington's army had been chased back to Ciudad Rodrigo, battered and beaten by the appalling hardships of the retreat, and with its spirits low. Wellington had been angered by the breakdown of order and discipline within the ranks, and in a general order, he placed the blame for the problem squarely at the feet of the regimental officers. What Wellington's army in the peninsula needed was time to rest and rebuild. What Wellington himself required was time to reflect and to formulate a strategy for the following year.
When one considers all the great gains of 1812, the stormings of Rodrigo and Badajoz, the thrashing of the French at Salamanca, and yet the year ended with the army back where they'd started at Rodrigo in late November. When the army arrived there, of course, Wellington issued his infamous memorandum, which was a long, detailed report where he slighted all of the officers and criticised them for not maintaining command and control of their men. You know, it was a very, very unhappy episode.
The situation for Napoleon becomes catastrophic. One by one, his allies desert him. The Prussians defect in spectacular fashion on the 1st of January, 1813. For the British, the situation is getting better. Encouraged by the disasters which have overwhelmed the retreating Grand Army of Napoleon, the British begin a process of resupplying Wellington's army. By the spring of 1813, Wellington's army is stronger than it has ever been.
Well, despite the terrible retreat from Burgos, Wellington's army recovered fairly quickly. Reinforcements came out from England, notably the Household Cavalry. two battalions of the 1st Foot Guards came out. The Hussars returned. So the army was in good spirits, it was in good health. They'd suffered a setback, but they, by the spring of 1813, they were ready to go again. And this time, one feels that Wellington knew there was no looking back. And when they left in May 1813, when they crossed over again and left Portugal for the last time, one senses that Wellington knew this was going to be it. This was going to be the campaign that would decide the Peninsular War.
Wellington knows that the French do not have enough troops to actually cover all possible eventualities. And so he devises a very clever deception plan. He makes it appear as though he's going to repeat the campaign of 1812, that he will actually drive directly towards Salamanca and Madrid. In reality, what he intends to do is to go to the north and to outflank the French.
Well, it's said that in 1813, when Wellington leaves Portugal on his way to his great victory at Vitoria, that he stopped at the frontier, raised his hat and said, "Farewell, Portugal, I will never see thee again." I just don't believe it. I mean, it doesn't sound a thing like Wellington for a start. And the man who told the story claimed to have got it from Sir Thomas Picton. But Sir Thomas Picton was 100 miles away that day, so I simply don't see the story can be true, however nice a story it might be.
Wellington's plan had provided for a flanking movement of the French defensive line by three columns of troops. His army set out on the 22nd of May, 1813, and the audacious tactic of constantly outflanking his enemy took the Frenchmen completely by surprise. Salamanca fell to the Allies on the 26th of May. Madrid was abandoned yet again by King Joseph on the 27th, while Zamora was seized on the 2nd of June. The French had been forced back as far to the north as Burgos. Wellington was in no mood to risk a repeat of the disasters of the previous year. And this time, he simply circumnavigated the city, forcing King Joseph to retreat even further to the north. Three times the French tried to take up defensive positions as they fell back, but each time they were outflanked by Wellington, forcing them to move further and further northeast. By the 19th of June, they had arrived at Vitoria. It was here that Wellington planned to attack.
The Battle of Vitoria, in a sense, was always pre-planned. Wellington intended to fight a great battle with the French in 1813. What he intended to do was to encircle the French army and to destroy it in what the Germans would later call a Kesselschlacht, a cauldron battle, a great battle of encirclement from which there could be no escape.
When Joseph's army pulled back, it took with him not only the three armies of the south, the centre and the army of Portugal. It also had all the civil servants, all the government officials, all the camp followers, all the women, the children. It had all the wagons, all the treasure that had been plundered and stolen over those years of French occupation. So you can imagine that there was a massive traffic jam building up in Vitoria. And when Wellington's army was in position on the morning of the 21st of June, the columns under Sir Thomas Graham, which was coming sweeping round to the north to attack Vitoria from that direction, you had Picton and Dalhousie coming out of the hills in the centre, and then you had Wellington himself right in the middle coming out of the valley of the Zadora, the river that runs through the battlefield, and then you had Hill, Rowland Hill, on the right flank. They were all in position. They would all converge at their respective points at the allotted time.
Wellington divided his force into four columns. On the right flank, he placed the 2nd Division under General Hill. On the centre left were the 3rd Division under General Picton and the 7th Division commanded by the Earl of Dalhousie. In the centre right were positioned the Light and 4th Divisions commanded by Wellington himself, while on the left flank stood the 1st Division under General Graham. On both flanks, the Anglo-Portuguese forces were reinforced by veteran Spanish troops. By deploying in this formation, Wellington had once again outwitted his opponent. Both King Joseph and his cohort Marshal Jourdan were expecting no British flanking attack. one full frontal assault on their center positions. General Hill's was the first Allied division into action, attacking the anchor of the French left flank here, along the heights of Puebla, in the early morning of the 21st of June. A fierce and bloody fight for control of the heights developed that lasted all morning. Sergeant John Spencer Cooper of the 7th Fusiliers was part of the assault.
A violent attack was made by our men on the enemy's left flank, which was posted at Macready Height. The contest was long and severe, but at length they were driven from the hill. Their left now being turned and rolled up, a general advance was made, and we marched with our splendid cavalry into a wood of fir trees.
The Battle of Vittoria opened by attack by Hill's troops on the French left along these craggy heights of Puebla. Now this really is a cliff face. It totally dominates the southern half of the battlefield of Vittoria. And one by one they began to sort of drive these French regiments off the top. The French themselves, looking up to their left, began to think, you know, this is the attack, and began to feed their troops up there. And of course, by doing so, they weakened their centre, which is where Wellington was waiting.
It was just before midday. Dalhousie's corps had not yet arrived on Wellington's left. Wellington knew that he could delay no longer. He gave preliminary orders for 4th Division and the Light Division to attack eastward down the valley. It was at this point that a Spanish peasant brought Wellington news of vital importance. The bridge at Tres Puentes was unguarded. Moreover, because of a bend in the river and a bluff, it could not be seen from the main French positions. Within minutes, Kent's brigade of the Light Division was rushing across the bridge, followed closely by the 15th Hussars. All the French could do was loose off a few rounds. Most of these landed ineffectually amongst the British, but one took the head off the Spanish peasant who had brought Wellington the vital intelligence.
It was now early afternoon, and in the center column, at the head of the 3rd Division, stood General Picton. Picton's short temper was the stuff of legend, and as he waited for the orders that had so far failed to arrive, he was growing very impatient indeed. Eventually, the irascible general decided to take matters into his own hands, and, without orders, he began to advance towards the Roman bridge over the River Zadora at Mendoza. It was a pivotal moment in the battle.
It was just after midday. Dalhousie's corps should have come to Mendoza, the village just behind me. It wasn't here, but one element of Dalhousie's corps had got through the mountains, and that was Picton's 3rd Division. And Picton was fighting mad. He had just watched Kent's brigade take the bridge at Tres Puentes, and he was anxious to get into the battle. But he had no orders. It was at this point that one of Wellington's ADCs rode up with orders for Lord Dalhousie. Picton angrily demanded to know what the orders were, and was absolutely furious when he was told that the orders concerned only the dispositions of the 7th, the 4th, and the 6th Divisions. Picton turned to one of his aides, and he said, "By God, Lord Wellington has forgotten us." And at that moment, one of the most famous incidents of insubordination in British military history occurred. Picton turned back to Wellington's ADC, and he said, "Sir, you may tell Lord Wellington that within 10 minutes, the 3rd Division shall attack and carry the bridge, and that 4th and 6th Divisions can move in support if they are able to do so." And with that, Picton turned to his leading regiment, the 88th, the Connaught Rangers. He said, "Come forward, you rascals, come forward, you villains, attack the bridge." And they did.
Steadily, the French positions began to crumble as the afternoon's fighting wore on. At 3 p.m., the Allies captured the hill and village of Aranez. At 4 p.m., came the decisive breakthrough. after the poorly led French infantry seemed to lose all heart and the stomach for the fight. By 5 o'clock in the afternoon, French forces were in a retreat that soon became a panic-stricken rout. In truth, there should have been no way out for them, but General Graham's column, which was supposed to deliver the killer blow by cutting in behind the French and securing the town, had failed to take its objective. The streets in Victoria itself became choked with plumed troops, and King Joseph himself narrowly avoided capture, as Sergeant Cooper remembered.
Beaten at all points, the enemy made a rush for the road to Pamplona, leaving behind them 151 pieces of cannon, 415 wagons laden with money and provisions and all their cattle, sheep and goats. Carriages blocked up the road. Then off we went with some cavalry at a dashing pace after King Joseph. But he saw his danger, sprang from his carriage, mounted a horse and gave us a slip.
The capture of all this massive wagon train really hampered the pursuit of the beaten French army. There were some 5 million francs in the military chest that the French had with them, and only 125,000 francs was recovered. The rest of it went into the pockets of very deserving British and Portuguese soldiers, and not a lot of French either. Wellington was so annoyed by this, he was so frustrated by this lack of a pursuit, that he called his army the scum of the earth.
The plundering of the French wagons prevented a full-scale Allied pursuit of Bonaparte's army, and probably saved many French lives. There were more than 8,000 Frenchmen killed or wounded during the Battle of Victoria. By contrast, the Allied side lost fewer than 5,000 men. In Britain, Wellington was conferred with yet another honour when the Prince Regent created him Field Marshal. In France, the mood was rather different. The report of the battle left the Emperor seething. Someone was required to carry the can for the debacle, and Napoleon certainly did not let brotherly love or sentiment interfere with his judgment. He promptly relieved King Joseph of his command, replacing him with Marshal Soult. "It is my wish that you do not interfere with the affairs of my armies," wrote Napoleon, who also forbade his brother to return to Paris on pain of arrest by the Minister of Police. "It is all his fault," cursed the Emperor. "The army was stupidly commanded. Of course the king is not a soldier, but he is responsible for his vices. If there was one man lacking in the army, it was a general. If there was one man too many, it was the king." It is a sobering thought that by the standards of the Peninsular War, the Battle of Victoria had not been particularly bloody. But it was hugely important in deciding the outcome of the entire conflict.
Victory of Victoria by Wellington's Allied army is generally regarded as being the battle that won the war. It drove the French back into the Pyrenees, and really there was no looking back for the French. Elsewhere in Europe, the Austrians, the Prussians and the Russians had been sitting on a fence waiting to see what was going to be happening. Now that was one of the crucial results of the Battle of Victoria. It brought the Allies back into the war, it galvanised them back into action. And Wellington himself was then guided by whatever events were going on elsewhere in Europe. But his first attention had to be San Sebastian.
In a war battle like the Battle of Victoria, it creates a whole range of difficulties. What's Wellington to do? Is he to stay on the defensive in Spain, or is he to chance his arm and try and drive the French across the Pyrenees and then invade France? Well, it's not quite over. He needs another logistics base, and the port of San Sebastian is the obvious one.
In the wake of the Battle of Victoria, the spotlight fell on the two border fortresses of San Sebastian and Pamplona. Wellington knew that he could never hope to secure a position along the Pyrenees while the French held these garrisons, which had been under siege since the end of June. Napoleon, too, made Soult aware of their importance in a specific order. You will re-establish my affairs in Spain and preserve San Sebastian and Pamplona, he wrote to his new commander. Upon his arrival in early July, Soult made a remarkable job of reorganizing the shattered French army, combining all his available forces into one large army of 100,000 men, known as the Army of Spain. Soult and Wellington knew that there were only three main routes through the Pyrenees. These were at Irun, the Pass of Maya, and the Pass at Roncesvalles. And both men were determined to secure these vital positions. Marshal Soult was not content to sit upon the defensive, waiting for Wellington's next move, and he formulated a plan for a French offensive that began on the 25th of July, 1813. What followed is remembered as the Battle of the Pyrenees.
Now the difficulty, of course, with the front on the Pyrenees is that it's 50 miles long. There are three major passes through the Pyrenees, and about 50 minor passes. And Soult is not going to sit on the other side of the Pyrenees, waiting for the British to actually come through in the spring when they want to. Soult is going to hit the British while they're unbalanced. And so, late in 1813, substantial French forces have crossed the Pyrenees and along the Kerr a whole series of bushes on Wellington's right flank as he tries to plug gaps and prevent the envelopment of his positions around San Sebastian.
While the fight for control of the Pyrenees raged, the British under Sir Thomas Graham continued to besiege the town of San Sebastian. It was not an easy task. One reason was that San Sebastian was situated on the coast, making traditional siege warfare a difficult business. Another was that there was a shortage of British ships, so an effective naval blockade could not be mounted. The only option left was to storm the town. Trenches were dug along the approaches to San Sebastian to provide cover for the infantry. And after a thunderous five-day artillery barrage, the Allied forces began their assault on the 31st of August. Commanded by General Ray, a Frenchman from Plantagenet, the determined Allied attacks foundered at the top of the breach in the walls of the town. Dead and wounded men lay in heaps, and those that had survived the advance up the slope of brick and masonry cowered behind them for cover. French musket balls flew over their heads. Then came the extraordinary order for the British artillery to fire over the heads of their own troops and into the French positions within the city. At a range of more than a quarter of a mile, it was an extremely risky undertaking. But somehow the British gunners maintained a high degree of accuracy, and they soon began to devastate the French positions. With cannonballs tearing holes in the French ranks, the Allies were able to return to the attack, and slowly the Frenchmen were pushed back. Although Ray and his men resisted fanatically. Despite their heroic efforts, they were forced back into the fort that overlooked the town, leaving San Sebastian at the mercy of the victorious Allied troops. The French fought with desperate courage, but one British survivor afterwards. They were driven from house to house, street to street, and it was late before their opposition was ended.
The storming was followed by the same sort of aftermath that followed Badajoz. And this time it was made worse by a fire, which we're still not sure how it happened, that engulfed and destroyed the town. Now the Spaniards themselves naturally complained about this. Wellington held an inquiry and exonerated all of his men. The Spaniards accused Wellington of firing the town because, of course, he thought that they were still trading with France.
Colonel Fraser of the Royal Horse Artillery wrote afterwards,
town, or over that part of it that the flames will allow. The scene is dreadful. No words can describe the horrors that struck the eye with every step. Heaps of dead in every corner, English, French, and Portuguese lie rolled on each other. With such resolution, did one side attack, and the other defend.
The fall of San Sebastian meant that Wellington could now bring his troops right up to the French border. The French retreated, crossed the River Bidassoa, which was in effect the border between the two, burnt the bridges at Bahobia, and then began to entrench on their side of the river. Wellington brought his men up to Fuenterrabia on the coast, and they began to filter into the passes of the Pyrenees, ready for the expected invasion.
On the momentous day of the 7th of October 1813, the Allied troops stepped on the French soil. They did this by crossing the Bidassoa River, which runs along the Spanish-French border. For the umpteenth time, Wellington gained the advantage over the French by attacking where sought least expected. These fellows think themselves invulnerable, but I shall beat them with ease. I can pour a greater force on certain points than they can concentrate to resist me, said Wellington. And he was proved right. By the time Soult realized what was happening, Wellington's men were across the river in huge numbers, and the French commander was forced to order a withdrawal to the River Nivelle. France had been invaded for the first time in almost 20 years, and for Napoleon, it was truly the beginning of the end. George Gleig of the 85th Light Infantry had fond memories of his first night spent on French soil.
I do not recollect many happier moments in my life. Stretched beside the fire, the quartermaster coming up with a supply of provisions in Rome. My meal was followed by a sleep such as kings might envy, though the heavens were my canopy and the green turf was my bed.
Wellington now went at great lengths to maintain discipline within the ranks as the Allied army moved deeper into France. He had seen at first hand the effects of guerrilla warfare on a hated invader, and he was determined that France's army, and not its people, should remain his only enemy. Our success depends upon the moderation, good conduct, and discipline of our troops. Hitherto, they have behaved well, wrote Wellington, although he was concerned about the Spanish troops. They are in such a miserable state that it is hardly fair to expect that they will refrain from plunder, particularly adverting to the miseries their own country has suffered from the invader. But if they plunder, they will ruin us all. On the 31st of October, the town of Pamplona fell to the Allied troops, and just 10 days later, Wellington won another spectacular victory over Marshal Soult's army at the River Nivelle, a triumph Wellington himself thought one of his most satisfying.
It's interesting how different the judgment of a general at the time is from the judgment of historians. Historians haven't the slightest doubt that Salamanca is Wellington's finest moment, or that the Battle of Vittoria is infinitely more important than the Battle of Nivelle in determining the outcome of the Peninsular War. But Wellington liked the Battle of Nivelle, and why is this? It was fought over a very wide front, over 25 miles, and it was an incredibly complex battle. It depended on Wellington being able to convince Soult that he was going to strike on his left flank, when in reality he was going to attack in the centre. It depended on almost perfect coordination, and for once everything went right.
He ripped down Soult's iron barrier like it was a screen of reeds. He hit it in overwhelming strength at all the given points. So these big British and Portuguese columns and the Spaniards at Ascain, they went in and they completely crushed all opposition that got in their way. And when we look back at all the various comments that Wellington made, all the great things he did, you know, he was not prone to exaggerations and not given to too many tributes. But for him to come out and say after the Battle of Nivelle, we have the best army in Europe, then I think that's a wonderful tribute.
As 1813 came to a close, Wellington was able to look back on a year of great achievements. With a series of fine victories, he and his horses had run the French armies out of Spain. Napoleon's interests in the peninsula had been ended, a state of affairs even he acknowledged when he agreed the Treaty of Valençay in December 1813. Refusing to renege on its alliance with the British, the Spanish government rejected the treaty, and in the end Napoleon released King Ferdinand from captivity, merely in the hope that he would take Spain out of the war.
Napoleon was still battling the Russians, the Prussians, the Austrians, the Swedes, in eastern Germany, and Wellington had no idea of what the outcome of the struggle might be. Consequently, he hung back. And it was really only the news of the great Allied victory at Leipzig on the 19th of October, 1813, that persuaded him to move forward.
Wellington had established a firm foothold in southwest France, where he and his army spent the winter months pushing on ever deeper into French territory. By April, they had reached Toulouse. This was to be the scene of the final great battle of the Peninsular War.
Once across the Adour, Wellington could now begin the blockade of Bayonne, the great French military base. The 1st Division and the 5th Division remained behind to lay siege to the place to stop the French getting out. Wellington's main field army, meanwhile, took itself off east in pursuit of Soult's army, their intention being to pin them in against the Pyrenees.
But Wellington had a fairly good idea that Soult's army was by this time very defensively minded. Napoleon's armies had been pushed back around Paris. It seemed that only a matter of time before Napoleon himself would have to abdicate and surrender to the Allies. And Soult must have been weighing his chances. What is the point of a victory over Wellington in the area of southwestern France when everything goes to blazes in Paris? And so we have Wellington taking chances at Toulouse, which we would not have seen him take a year earlier.
The city of Toulouse is all but surrounded by the River Garonne, over which Wellington built a pontoon bridge during the early days of April. It was only after more than 19,000 men had crossed to the far side of the river that the bridge collapsed and was swept away, leaving that portion of Wellington's army totally isolated. Had Soult elected to attack this small, stranded force, the results would have been catastrophic. But the French commander elected to remain within the city walls.
Throughout March and early April, it rained incessantly. The Garonne at Toulouse is 200 yards wide. The river was now in spate. British engineers measured the current at 2 yards per second. With the exception of the fortified suburb of St. Cyprien on the western bank, Soult had withdrawn his army into Toulouse on the eastern side of the Garonne. Here, behind canal lines, behind walls, and with a fortified ridge to the east, he felt secure from British attack.
Despite the raging currents, the Allied army somehow managed to cross the River Garonne, but Wellington's troubles were only just beginning. With its fortified walls and steep-banked canals, Toulouse was in danger of turning into another Badajoz or Busaco. Wellington would have to lure Soult out of the city in order to fight on ground of his own choosing.
What Wellington has to do is to actually convince the French that he's attacking from the west, while in fact moving substantial forces around to the east. It's the only way that he can actually begin to take a city which is really a large fortress. What Wellington does is to launch a subsidiary attack against the suburb of St. Cyprien, which is on the western side of the Garonne. in order to convince Soult that indeed he is coming from the west, and this will encourage Soult to actually redeploy his forces to the western side of the city. Now, in the meantime, what he has done is sent Beresford on a large flanking movement. And the idea is that at a predetermined time, Beresford is actually going to attack up the Calvinet Ridge from the southeast, from the direction that Soult is not expecting an attack.
The Battle of Toulouse began at 5 a.m. on the 10th of April, 1813. It was Easter Sunday.
Now, unfortunately, Sir Thomas Picton, commander of the 3rd Division, who was always impetuous, launches a frontal assault across the canal lines. He is almost at the junction of the Garonne and the canals. And one of Beresford's subordinate commanders, General Friere, a Spanish commander, launches his corps in a frontal assault at the northeastern part of the Calvinet Ridge. And this attack runs into very, very fierce French resistance. Is repelled with great loss, and Friere's corps collapses into chaos. And Wellington, watching this, remarked most unkindly, "I had never thought to see 10,000 men in a foot race." Beresford is in position, he attacks from the southeast. The French try to counterattack, and then it's the old story of line over column. The French column is smashed to pieces by sustained fire of Beresford's infantry. And the French abandon the Calvinet Ridge, pulling back behind the canal lines and the city walls of Toulouse.
Sergeant John Spencer Cooper of the 7th Royal Fusiliers was among those men that attacked Toulouse.
The troops that engaged the French batteries now closed upon the masses that came pouring over the hill, and the struggle became tremendous. But, as usual, the Red Jackets prevailed, and they stood triumphant on the hill. A poor fellow I had been talking to was now borne along, his leg hanging by a bit of flesh. His wife was killed at Salamanca while giving drink to a wounded man.
Eventually fell, but Marshal Soult and his army managed to escape to the south. Despite withdrawing further to the southeast, the Allied army finally caught up with the French, and on the 17th of April 1814, Wellington and Soult signed a peace accord. The greatest irony of all is that the Battle of Toulouse need never have been fought. 2 days after the battle, Wellington received the news that Napoleon had unconditionally abdicated on the 6th of April, 4 days before the fighting began. It was a little over 6 years since French troops had first occupied Madrid. During those years, Portugal, and in particular Spain, had suffered almost unimaginable devastation and hardships. Both countries faced a long road to recovery. France, meanwhile, had paid dearly for Napoleon's vaulting ambition. Although no one can be completely sure, estimates put her loss in manpower during the war at more than 250,000. If these losses were not enough, the grinding peninsular campaign had also drained the French coffers and put a huge strain on the country's treasury. It was impossible to accurately count the many thousands of British troops that were killed and wounded during the fight against the tyranny of Napoleon Bonaparte. The cost to the British Exchequer was clear, however. £18 million in cash alone was spent on fighting the war. There were many reasons for the final Allied victory. The contributions of the Spanish and Portuguese people cannot be overstated, and the part played by the armies of those countries was also hugely important. The Allied cause was helped by the poor leadership that was often the curse of the French army. How different the outcome might have been had Napoleon himself been in command for the duration of the war is a tantalizing but unanswerable question. There is little doubt, however, that the principal reason for the Allied victory was the leadership of Wellington. It is an extraordinary fact that except for the period of his recall to England in the wake of the Convention of Cintra scandal, Wellington had not taken a single day's leave during the Peninsular War.
The British army in the Peninsula could not have functioned without Wellington. The British military system was so chaotic, it was such a mess, that it required a man of transcendent genius to make the components weld into a whole which could take on a properly constituted European army. And we've really only had two in our history. One was Marlborough at the beginning of the 18th century, and the other was Wellington at the beginning of the 19th century. No other man could have made that army work.
I think when summing up Wellington's own contribution to the Peninsular War, there's no better way than the man himself, because 30 years afterwards he was asked, you know, what did you do? What did you feel you did in the Peninsula? What was your job? And in typical Wellington fashion, he said,
I went abroad and took command of the army, and I never returned or even quitted the field till the nations of the Peninsula War were delivered from the French armies, till I had invaded France, won the Battle of Toulouse, established the British army within French territory, which I governed several departments, till the general peace was signed at Paris, and until the British cavalry had been sent by sea to Portugal, Spain and the south of France, had marched home across France, and embarked for England in the ports of France in the British Channel.
The real impact of the Peninsula, of course, was a drain on French resource. It was, as Napoleon said, the Spanish ulcer, the running sore. It also allowed the British army to develop. So when the army landed in August of 1808, they weren't regarded as much as a threat by the French. But the army would blossom, it would come to fruition, and this is why we get this great comment by Wellington following the Battle of Nivelles. We have the best army in Europe.
The Peninsular War mattered because it proved that Britain was ready to fight Napoleon, that Britain was a serious partner in a war against Napoleon, that Britain could be relied upon not to fight to the death of the last Austrian, that Britain, in other words, had a serious commitment to the continent. That was why the Peninsular War mattered. That was Wellington's achievement.
And there it is, sapping away all the time. Not just the physical strength of France, but the psychological dominance that Napoleon exerts over Europe. Because if you're a German nationalist, if you're an Austrian nationalist or a Russian nationalist, and you don't like that Napoleonic Empire one little bit, then there's that beacon down there in the Iberian Peninsula. Hey, there are still people who refuse to accept Napoleonic Europe. There are still people fighting. There are still people standing on their feet, refusing to kneel before Napoleon's empire. And that ultimately is what the significance of the Peninsula campaign is. It's a signal to the rest of Europe that it's not over yet.
And so, 7 years after the war began here, on the Portuguese frontier, it has ended deep inside France itself. The Redcoats, well, some go home, some go to a war that's winding down in North America. Wellington goes to the Congress of Vienna, and Sharp, to my utter astonishment, retires to Normandy. They surely all thought their fighting days were over, but Napoleon escapes from Elba, and in a climax no novelist would dare devise, the two greatest generals of the era at last meet head to head on a ridge south of Brussels. Wellington beats Napoleon at Waterloo, but it was a close run thing, a very close run thing, and he surely would never have won without the peninsular veterans who formed the core of his otherwise makeshift army. They were great men, those peninsular soldiers. Wellington famously called them the scum of the earth, mere scum of the earth, but that wasn't his only verdict on them. He doubted their motives for volunteering. They mostly joined for drink, he said, but it's wonderful, wonderful what fine fellows we have made of them. And they were fine fellows. And it was here in Portugal and Spain that they wrote their own stories, stories of grief and loss, of hardship and, yes, laughter, and tales of victory which, once airbrushed by history and by us novelists, became tales of glory too. Tales told here, in the fighting fields of the Peninsular War.
Coming up next, it's Lock and Load with the ever-entertaining Ali Ermey, who puts some iconic machine guns to the test and along the way reveals how the potato digger machine gun got its name and why one 1965 weapon still reigns supreme today.